two microphones so everybody's good. He's off his game or something here.
Praise the Lord. So glad to have you to join us tonight on the live stream, Wednesday night, midweek service. I know that we're just going to continue moving along despite all these things that would like to hinder us and hold us back. We are still worshiping God in spirit and in truth. Wherever you're at, God is there. He is omnipresent. The same spirit that is here is the same spirit that will visit you in your home as you listen to this message and let the Holy Spirit speak unto you. If you just lend an ear, you can hear what the Spirit has to say. And I'm just praying and believing for with you about any requests that you have in your life. We're praying for all those that are shut in and those that are sick. We pray for people in mind, body, and spirit as God has created us. And we pray for those that are struggling with what's going on in the world today as we pray for the end of this epidemic and the end of this crisis and the end. When we're praying that God, being the author of all that is good, would just work this together for the good, because that's what he does. It's our job to trust and believe and to pray and to have hope in him, and it's his job to do the impossible and to work this together for our good. So I'm believing that. I'm making the most of this time. I'm using this time I have off from work to advance the kingdom of God and to love on my family, and I hope that you are using your time wisely, whatever it is that you're doing, that you're not spending it fretting and worrying and wringing your hands, but that you're using it to worship the Lord in a greater measure and a greater ability. And that's what we're praying for in the service tonight, that God would just use this time. And I pray that you would not just put this on in the background, but you know, you can come to church and you could be present here, but you could be mentally checked out. You could be tuning in to this service now on your phone or on your Facebook, and you could let everything around you distract you, or you could really tune in and really get a word from God right now. And I pray that that's what you've got your mind made up to do right now. And when you listen to this, whether it be live or later, I pray that you really just allow God to have his way with you in this time and really be open and receptive to the Holy Spirit pouring into your life, no matter where you're at in the busyness of whatever you're doing. Take a few moments just to single out this time for God and let him have his way. Worship along with the music. Worship just like you were here. For like I said, we worship God neither in the mountain nor in Jerusalem, but in spirit and in truth. And you can do that right where you're at from your house, and the kingdom of God will advance. Pray with me tonight. Father, we just come to you, Lord, with our hearts lifted up, God, because we approach the throne room of your grace and mercy. God, we come before you, God, who is the omnipresent, the omnipotent, the omniscient God, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, the name of whom every knee shall bow and every tongue confess. God, we come before you in all your royal majesty, God, as being the Lord that you are, the great I am, Father. We come before you humbly tonight, God, to ask, God, that you would speak into our lives, that you would minister to us, and that we could feel your real spirit, God, in our house. I pray for all the churches that are live streaming tonight, God, and all the congregations that are tuning in, Father. I pray that your spirit would just go out and go forth, and that your word would not return void, God, but that it would have an impact, God, on lives. I pray, God, Lord, that lost souls would hear it, Father. I pray, God, that eyes and blinded eyes would be opened, deaf ears would hear and understand, God, and hardened hearts would be softened from a heart of stone to one of flesh to receive your word. And I pray that those of us that are your children would allow this time to be conducive to you working and ministering in our lives, Father. I pray for all of those, Lord, and I believe it, Lord, even as we enter into worship here now, Father, for we ask it in agreement, everybody together in agreement, and you say together with me right now, in Jesus' name, amen. Y'all worship with him tonight.
I see him there, the great I am, a crown of thorns upon his head. The Father's heart displayed for cursed your name, and even still you bore our shame and paid the cost. Oh God, we thank you for the cross. Behold the Lamb, the story of redemption.
You will reign forevermore, the victor.
we overcome. For the Lord our God is able. For the Lord our God is able. Yes, the Lord our God is able.
Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for this time to be gathered together all across this area, Lord. Lord, we have families represented from everywhere, Lord, here to praise you today, God, to hear a word from you, Father, and just to get some encouragement for this week, Lord. And I just pray, God, that you would be with each and every family that's represented here today, God, that you would just lift each and every one of them up, Lord. Encourage them, God. Help them have faith that you are in control of everything, Lord, and that we have nothing to fear, Lord, because we are your children. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
given up on me by now, I would have labeled me a lost cause. Cause I feel just like a lost cause. If I were you, I would have turned around and walked away. I would have labeled me beyond repair. Cause I feel like I'm beyond repair. Oh, but somehow you don't see me like I do. Somehow you're still here. You're the God who stays. You're the God who stays. You're the one who runs in my direction. When the whole world walks away, you're the God who stands with wide open arms. And you tell me nothing I have ever done could separate my heart from the God who stays. I used to hide every time I thought I let you down. Always thought I had to earn my own. But I'm learning you don't work that way. Cause somehow you don't see me like I do. Somehow you're still here. You're the God who stays. You're the God who stays. You're the one who runs in my direction. When the whole world walks away, you're the God who stays. With wide and you tell me nothing I have ever done could separate my heart from the God who stays. My shame can't separate, my guilt can't separate, my past can't separate. I'm yours forever. My sin can't separate.
Of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty pair bow down with care. God gave his son to win. His erring child he reconciled and pardoned from could we think the ocean fair and were the skies of parchment made, were every star on earth a quill and every man a scribe by trade to write the love of God above would drain the ocean dry, nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. Oh, love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong. It shall forevermore endure the saints and angels' song.
Praise the Lord. I saw a little thing on Facebook that said that we're all televangelists now. I've never wanted to be a televangelist, but I've wanted to preach the gospel and allow the word to go forth. Thank you, brother. Just before I came up, I knew I was going to need a water, and I got Dylan to get me one. If you want to turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Daniel, chapter 2, I want to share a word with you that God has imparted to my heart. And I just want to speak to you tonight, wherever you're at, and I pray that the Holy Spirit would just really open your ears, your eyes, and your heart to receive what the Spirit has to say tonight. So you turn with me. I'll talk to you for a few minutes about a merging or a merger. Praise the Lord. You know, we have companies and corporations now that will often undergo mergers, and the hope and the idea is that many times a much larger, more powerful, well-financed company can take a company that has potential but may not have been able to exercise that potential and merge with it and take it over in the hopes of growing and nurturing and developing the potential that they see in that company. And a lot of times these companies like to come in on the ground level because they see such potential in an idea or in a company, but they see that there's limitations in terms of their ability to grow that potential, whether it be finances or personnel or training or experience, or they see the limitations of the company, and so they want to get in early because they see that they can overcome those limitations, and by overcoming those limitations, they can grow the potential of the corporation or the company. And by getting in early on and investing early on, they get to pay get paid big dividends on the investment they make in growing and nurturing that company. There are things known as hostile takeovers as well, in which there are predatory companies that try to merge. And I want to draw a sort of analogy, if you would allow me, and bring that over into the spiritual realm and let you know that there is a spiritual merger that God wants to take place with you. He wants to empty you of you so He can fill you with Him. He wants to merge your nature with His divine nature and give you an impartation of His Holy Spirit in order to make you realize the full potential that He sees in you, that He actually placed within you, so that He can unlock that potential and that ability so that you can become the best you that you can possibly be, because you can only do that under the power and the anointing of God. But there's also an enemy, we know. We know the enemy seeks whom he may devour, roaming to and fro. He's looking to do a hostile takeover, amen? He wants to create a merger between your sinful nature and his destructive nature so that he can help you, he can help you hit the gates of hell wide open, amen? That's his desire, is he wants to put you on a highway to hell, and he wants to accelerate your process in getting there. And we know that God's design and God's desire is to save you from that broad and wide path that leads to destruction. He doesn't want a hostile takeover. He doesn't want the enemy causing you to do things that you don't really want to do. We know the Apostle Paul, as he wrestled with it, he said that those things that I desire are the things that I don't do. Those things that I don't desire are the things that I do. Why? Because of the sinful nature of man. See, a hostile company will come in and exploit the underdeveloped parts of a limited company in order to take that company over, not just because they see the potential in it, but because they see the money that they want to rob and they steal and take from the original investors in the company. And that's what the enemy is doing. He's desiring to rob from you the potential that God placed in you when He created you in His image. Amen. I've been talking about, in the midst of this virus epidemic, that we can there's probably a contingent of people that want to blame God and another contingent of people that want to blame the enemy. But I'm telling you, sometimes on this earth, things just happen. Things happen on this earth, and I know that my Bible tells me that every good and perfect gift comes from the Father above. He is the author of everything that is good. I know that my Word tells me that He causes all things to work together for our good, for those who love the Lord and are called according to His purpose. Amen. That's what He does. So He can take something like this, and He can advance the kingdom of God. For every action, there's an equal or opposite reaction. My God knows how to react to every situation that presents itself on this earth to cause it to work together for the good of those who love the Lord and are called according to His purpose. And listen, the gates of hell will not prevail. It will not slow down. It will not obstruct. It will not in any way hinder the will of God. Why? Because we pray His kingdom come, His will be done. It shall be done. Amen. We said where two or three are gathered and ask in His name according to His will, that it shall be done. And He gave us the keys to the kingdom. Amen. He's already earned it. He's already won the victory. Amen. He said, I give you the keys to the kingdom. What you bind on earth is bound in heaven. What you loose on earth is loose in heaven. So grab a hold of that tongue and speak life over every situation, for the power of life and death is in the tongue. Do not speak negatively about this virus. Do not speak negatively about what's going on. Go ahead right now and speak the will and word of God, that all things shall work together for the good, and that everything's going to be okay, and that everything's going to be all right, and this is not the end of the world as we know it, that this world has not yet entered into the tribulation time and into the tribulation period. There'll come a day and an hour whenever he'll come and rapture his church and he'll take them away. Listen, I've said it before and I'll say it again. I'm telling you that at the moment that the world reaches its highest climax in which the gospel is being going out through Facebook and through YouTube and through all these other digital platforms, and it's being preached in every nation of the world, and the Spirit has stretched himself over the entire earth, and the people of God are anointed by God to preach the gospel, and it's going to be going out and it's going to be at its height. But at the same time, there's going to be a great rejection and a great turning away. How do I know that? Because when the word goes out, one of two things are going to happen. People are going to get saved or people are going to reject. One of the two is going to happen. And I'm telling you that as the word goes out, you're going to have two things happening at the same time. One, you're going to have the greatest coming and flocking to the word of God and to the gospel, and people are going to be saved and set free from the bondage of sin. But at the same time, you're also going to have the greatest number rejecting and choosing a sinner's hell over the grace and the mercy of God that's being extended to them. And there's going to reach that tipping point. I like to think of the law of diminishing returns. The law of diminishing returns can apply to the Holy Spirit. Well, the Father only knows when that reaches its tipping point. When it does, he says, my Spirit is doing that earth no longer any good. He's going to say, son, go and get your bride, the perfect, spotless, blameless bride that you have washed clean with your blood, and go and bring them home. Go ahead and bring them home. We've reached that tipping point. And no man knows the day or the hour, only the Father who is in heaven. Why? Because he is omniscient. He is omnipotent. He is omnipresent. He knows all things, all times, and in all places. Glory to God. All things at all times and in all places. And he has all power over them all. Amen. He is omnipresent, omniscient, omnipresent, omnipotent, and omniscient. Amen. Glory to God. You can get tongue-tied if you ain't careful. Amen. But he is at all times and all places, and he will know the day and the hour. He's the only one, the Father in heaven, and he will instruct the Son to go and fetch my church. Amen. I want to talk to you for just a few minutes tonight about merging. Amen. God desires to merge your spirit with his and to overpower that sinful nature and that sinful desire. I'm going to continue on this same sort of theme, but I'm going to speak more to the saved people tonight. I've been talking about how Jesus looked at this, at the sickness of the man with palsy in Matthew chapter 9, and he didn't first say, son, take up thy mat and walk, you are healed, but he first said, son, thy sins are forgiven. So when I say in this midst of this time, I believe the word of the Lord spoke to me, and he said in the midst of this sickness and disease, as people's bodies are giving way to pneumonia and other symptoms of this virus, he's going to look at people in desperate need and he's going to say, son or daughter, thy sins are forgiven. I believe there's a great coming to the gospel at this day and this hour. People are reaching out to God in their desperate times and in their desperate moments, and they are finding God. Because the word says, ask and ye shall receive. Knock and the door shall be opened. Amen. Seek and ye shall find. I believe there's some seeking, asking, and knocking going on. And he's looking down and he's saying, your sins are forgiven. Somebody needs to praise God for the lost souls that are coming to the kingdom right now. Amen. I believe there are people that are under the influence of live stream all over this nation that are coming to know God through this pandemic. I believe through social platforms, the gospel's being preached and lives are being changed. You can't contain the gospel of God. I tell you, I would rather see this church full, but all I need to know is that God's Spirit is still with us and still alive and still working all over this earth. And I know that it is. And I'm asking you to believe with me tonight and pray for lost souls to come to Jesus tonight. Somebody say, yes, Jesus. Amen. Glory to God. That's an agreement prayer right there. That's where real prayer is at, in agreement. If you don't know that, you need to learn that. That real prayer is in agreement, where two or three are gathered. Amen. That's why we gather. We're gathering socially right now, but we're still agreeing in one spirit. Amen. Glory to God. If you would, turn with me in your Bibles to Daniel chapter 2. And we're going to look at something right here that God has just opened my eyes to tonight. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. This is a very familiar piece of scripture if you know the Word of God, but I want to share it with you tonight and maybe open your eyes to some things through the Spirit of God that you might not have be keen to at this moment in time. Maybe you've been keen on it before, but now's an awakening time and an awakening moment. That's what I'm believing is going forth and going out during this time, is a great awakening. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Somebody praise God wherever you're at tonight. Somebody praise the name of the Lord Jesus in your homes tonight. Oh, glory to God. We praise you tonight, Jesus. We praise you tonight, Jesus. We praise you tonight, Jesus. Oh, God, I'm not worthy, but you are. And we praise you tonight, Jesus. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. I'm going to summarize this first part of this chapter, and then we're going to dive in into the last. I'm going to tell you that there Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon at this time, and the people of Israel have been taken captive, and they had taken the best of Israel back to Babylon with them. And here among them are Daniel and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And during this time period, the king has asked the astrologers and all the wise men of the kingdom to interpret a dream. And this was not too uncommon at this time. They would often have dreams and visions they asked to be interpreted, and they surrounded themselves with wise people. Now, these different men were very, they were wise, as it says, wise men. They were keen. Amen? Now, they were able to use this wisdom to manipulate and to achieve positions of importance politically. And they would often be surrounding a king. And listen, you're not going to deliver a word to a king that they don't want to hear. If he tells you a dream, you're going to interpret it in a manner that's favorable to you and favorable to him. Amen. You're trying to work things together for your favor. Remember, they're not working by God's principle that he works all things together. They were working by their principle, I'll work things together for my good. Amen. Now, so the king would, or the ruler, the leader, whoever it is, would present this dream. And then they would, of course, being wise, they would be able to say, well, this means this and that means this. And they would make all these connections using their knowledge of the kingdom, their knowledge of the personal knowledge of the king, their personal knowledge of his inner workings. And they would connect things, whether they were true or not. They made them sound true. They made it sound good. They cleverly devised a good story. Well, okay, but this time, I believe Nebuchadnezzar, it was kind of, I guess, as a leader, kind of a foolish demand that he made. But I think that he was a little put out and a little fed up with inauthenticity. I think that he knew that these people were pandering to him at many times. And I think this dream had stirred him. You ever had a dream that stirred you? You woke in the night and you just, you know, a lot of dreams you just say, well, silly, that's so silly, you know. And you go back to sleep. A lot of dreams, that's ridiculous. You go back. But sometimes a dream will wake you and it shakes you and it stirs you. And I always tell people, you know a dream's spiritual almost immediately when you wake up. A lot of people wonder about it. Was this a spiritual dream? And they start trying to figure out meanings to the dream. I believe you know almost instantly if a dream was spiritual when you woke up. And some people may not have had one. But I believe you know. My wife often dreams. I don't dream very often, and my dreams are kind of outlandish or crazy, and they usually attach to whatever I'm worrying about at the moment, and they exacerbate, you know, whatever situation I might be, you know. I don't really stress over things, but I got this little worry in the back of my mind, and I just keep on doing what I got to do, and that little worry is just residing there, and somehow that comes out of my dream sometimes. But Teresa often has dreams, spiritual dreams, And I could go into stories, but that's for another day and another time. But at this particular time, Nebuchadnezzar, he not only wanted the interpretation of the dream, he wanted them to tell him what he dreamed, then give him the interpretation, or as they told the dream, to interpret it. So the all the wise men are like, what you ask cannot be done. There's not a man among men. They give him the excuse that God does not dwell down among men. And there's no way for us to know what you ask is impossible. In other words, they weren't willing to stick their neck out there and start guessing because they knew what it was going to cost them. So they were trying to hedge their bets and trying to, play this game the best they knew how by trying to appeal to what he has asked them to do was impossible to do, and hoping that he would accept that if they all come together in agreement that he would do it. But he didn't accept it. I believe this dream had stirred him. It had stirred him spiritually, and he was disturbed by this dream, and it wasn't a good enough answer. And so even though he had asked them something very difficult, and he was probably being a little stubborn at this point, we all can be, but especially those in leadership sometimes can get fed up, and we can get stubborn about things if we're not careful. And he was stubborn at this moment. Why? Because he orders the killing of all of those people, of all those wise men and all those interpreters. Why? Because not one could come forth and tell him what he dreamed. And so he said, y'all are just a bunch. Basically, he was saying, you're all a bunch of false prophets. You're all, your powers that you say you have are all fake. And all your knowledge and wisdom, you don't know anything. And you have been a disservice to me and my kingdom. So he decides to kill them all. Amen. Daniel gets word of this. Daniel, in the midst of captivity, gets word of this. So when Daniel gets word of this, he says, why is the king, why is what the king asks is too difficult? Why does he ask such a thing? Why would he ask such a thing of people? This is, it's what he's asked is too difficult. No one can reveal it. Nobody can do this. So he decides to step in and to intercede. He decides he's going to go to his God, the God of gods, the King of kings, and the Lord of lords. So word gets back. Verse 13, it says, so the decree was issued to put the wise men to death. And men were sent to look for Daniel. This is chapter 2, verse 13. And men were sent to look for Daniel and his friends to put them to death. When Arioch, the commander of the king's guard, had gone out to put to death the wise men of Babylon, Daniel spoke to him with wisdom and tact. He asked the king's officer, why did the king issue such a harsh decree? Arioch then explained the matter to Daniel. At this, Daniel went into the king and asked for time so that he might interpret the dream for him. Daniel stepped out in faith, went to the king, and said, give me some time. I'm going to pray to my God so that I can interpret this dream for you. It says, verse 17, it says, then Daniel returned to his house and explained the matter to his friends, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He goes back. Now listen, who does he do? He goes back to his home and confides in his friends who he knew were strong in the Lord. He goes back and he confides in them. You know, we need to do that. Amen? Sometimes we feel like we need to carry the burden ourselves, and we don't, we're private and we don't need, what does Daniel do? Daniel goes back and tells, we need you praying. Need you praying. So he tells us, he urged them to plead for mercy from God from heaven concerning this mystery. And so that he and his friends may not be executed with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. During the night, the mystery was revealed to Daniel in a vision. And I love this next part. I love this next part because so often we pray for things and then we've not got the gratitude enough to thank God when he answers the prayer. We might say thank God and then we revel in the victory that we've won or in whatever it is that we have prayed for, whether it was a job or promotion or a vehicle or, we could go on and on and on and on. And, but if you prayed hard enough and long enough for something, it's going to mean something to you when God gives it to you. Amen? And we need to be careful. We need to be careful to give praise to God. And Daniel praised God of heaven and said, I love his prayer. It says, praise be to the name of God forever and ever. Wisdom and power are his. He changes times and seasons. He sets up kings and deposes them. Amen? I love his prayer. He sets up kings and deposes them. He gives wisdom to the wise. Where do they get their wisdom? From God. And knowledge to the discerning. How do they discern? But from knowledge from God. He reveals deep and hidden things. He knows what lies in darkness, and light dwells within him. I thank and praise you, O God of my fathers. You have given me wisdom and power. You have made known to me what we ask of you. You have made known to us the dream of the king. And notice the us there. Amen. He recognizes that he has people praying with him. Amen. In agreement, remember? Pray in agreement. He remembered that we prayed in agreement for God to show mercy and spare them. The king asked Daniel, also called Belshazzar, "Are you able to tell me what I saw in my dream and interpret it?" Daniel replied, "No wise man, enchanter, magician, or diviner can explain the king the mystery he has asked about. But there is a God in heaven who reveals mysteries." Daniel's preaching the gospel now. Amen. He is asked about. Amen. He has shown King Nebuchadnezzar what will happen in the days to come. In other words, he's saying, my God has spoken to you. That's why you have this dream. You may not serve him, and you may not honor him, but my God has spoken to you. Did you know that God will go to unbelievers? Amen. There's a brother I know in ministry that he talks about how many Muslims who are seeking truth, God comes to them in dreams and reveals that Jesus is Lord. Then they risk life and limb. Why? Because a convert to Christianity who was once a Muslim, it's punishable in Sharia law to murder them, to kill them, for them to convert. And so they're ostracized and disowned by their families and often have to go and live under witness protection. But God reveals. Amen. Just a sidebar. So he shows him what will happen in the days to come. Your dream and visions that pass through your mind as you lay on your bed are these. As you were lying there, O king, your mind turned to things to come. And the revealer of mysteries showed you what is going to happen. As for me, this mystery has been revealed to me, not because I have greater wisdom than other living men. He was careful to give God credit. Not because I have greater wisdom than other living men, but so that you, O king, may know the interpretation and that you may understand what went through your mind. In other words, Daniel's saying, I'm on divine assignment, specifically from God, at this moment, to reveal to you what he already shown you in this vision, the meaning. You looked, O king, and there before you stood a large statue, an enormous, dazzling statue, awesome in appearance. The head of the statue was made of pure gold, its chest and arms of silver, and its belly and thighs of bronze, its legs of iron, its feet partly of iron and partly of baked clay. While you are watching, a rock was cut out, not by human hands. It struck the statue on its feet of iron and clay and smashed them. Then the iron, the clay, the bronze, the silver, and the gold were broken to pieces at the same time and became like a chaff on a threshing floor in the summer. The wind swept them away without leaving a trace. But the rock that struck the statue became a huge mountain and filled the whole earth. This was the dream, and now we will interpret it to the king. This is verse 36. You, O king, are the king of kings. The God of heaven has given you dominion and power and might and glory. And in your hands he has placed mankind and the beasts of the field and the birds of the air. Wherever they live, he has made you ruler over all of them. You are the head of gold. That's a pretty good introduction if he's probably got him tuned in at this point. Amen. You know, he's probably got him tuned in. And? Yes. And it says, after you, verse 39, after you, another kingdom will rise inferior to you. I'm sure at this point, yes, go on. Inferior to you. Next, a third kingdom, one of bronze, will rule over the whole earth. Finally, there will be a fourth kingdom, strong as iron, for iron breaks and smashes everything. And as iron breaks things to pieces, so it will crush and break all the others. Just as you saw that the feet and the toes were partly of baked clay and partly of iron, so this will be a divided kingdom. Yet it will have some of the strength of iron in it, even as you saw the iron mixed with clay. As the toes were partly iron and partly clay, so the kingdom will be partly strong and partly brittle. And just as you saw the iron mixed with baked clay, so the people will be a mixture and will not remain united any more than iron mixes with clay. In the time of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that will never be destroyed. Now he's speaking to the history of the earth. He's basically talking of the lineage of time between Nebuchadnezzar and Jesus. Amen. We could go through the historical kingdoms and name the historical kingdoms from Alexander the Great down to the Roman Empire and the fall of the Roman Empire. Okay, but that's for a historical lesson that you can dig in and dive deep, or a Sunday school lesson that we can dive in. Let's stick to where we want to get with the Word of God tonight. So, this kingdom will be set up, verse 44, that will never be destroyed, nor will it be left to another people. It will crush all of those kingdoms and bring them to an end. But it will itself endure forever. This is the meaning of the vision of the rock cut out of mountains, but not by human hands, a rock that broke the iron, the bronze, the clay, and the silver, and the gold to pieces. The great God has shown the king what will take place in the future. The dream is true, and the interpretation is trustworthy. Then King Nebuchadnezzar fell prostrate before Daniel and paid him honor and ordered that an offering and incense be presented to him. The king said to Daniel, "Surely your God is the God of gods and the Lord of kings and a revealer of mysteries, for you were able to reveal this mystery." Then the king placed Daniel in a high position and lavished many gifts on him. He made him ruler over the entire province of Babylon and placed him in charge of all its wise men. Moreover, at Daniel's request, the king appointed Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego administrators over the province of Babylon, while Daniel himself remained in the royal court. Amen. Now, I want to parallel this with Matthew chapter 12 tonight. I want to particularly focus in on this idea of merger. I want to particularly focus in on the fact that the vulnerability of this statue, you know, if you go back to Greek mythology, you could say the Achilles heel. Amen? The weak, vulnerable point of this statue lay in the divided kingdom between the merging or the mixing of iron and clay. Amen. Now, the problem lie was that though iron was strong enough to destroy all the other kingdoms, the mixing of clay, the brittle clay, left it vulnerable to destruction despite its strength. Despite the qualities that made it a strong and mighty kingdom, the weaknesses and the vulnerabilities made it susceptible to destruction. You could think of this is not even the parallel I wanted to draw, but you could think of a little leaven in the dough runs the entire batch. Amen? You know, I often, this is a crude analogy, but it gets the point across to young people. And I often share this when I'm teaching on sin, because they always want to say just a little this or a little that. They always want to make excuses about little things they allow into their ears, minds, and hearts. And I say, you know, I tell them, this is a great meal, but if you put a little doo-doo in there, you still want to eat this great meal? No, it ruins the entire meal. I don't care if it is filet mignon or caviar or a porterhouse T-bone steak on the bone-in ribeye. I don't, whatever tickles your fancy and makes you lick your chops. You mix a little bit of something in there nasty, and it's no longer appetizing. It ruins the whole batch. this weak, divided part, this merging, made it vulnerable. The Word is careful to instruct to be in the world but not of the world. That we are not to be married to this world. That we are not of this world, but that we are ambassadors for the kingdom of God. That this is not our, this is a strange land to us that's filled with strange people. That yes, we, you know, just like he told the children of Israel in Babylon, you know, go ahead, you're going to be here a while, get comfortable, but this ain't your home. That's our view as believers. But we make ourselves vulnerable as believers by mixing too much with the world. You know, many times in the Word, they told the Israelites not to intermarry, not to intermingle, not because God was a racist. It wasn't that he didn't want the mixing of races because God liked one people. It's because God had set apart a people as being holy, and he didn't want their religion defiled by the polytheism of the other surrounding. He didn't want their false gods to come and defile the one holy true God. But yet we bend our knees at so many altars and mix ourselves with so many things and merge ourselves, and we're setting ourselves up constantly for a hostile takeover. He's given you the armor of faith, but you're mixing it with feet of clay. He's given you all that you need to defend yourself against the enemy. He won the battle, and he gave you all the armor, the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the shoes of peace, the belt of truth. Amen. Glory to God. The sword of the Spirit and the shield of faith. He gave you what you needed when he shed his blood on Calvary. But we're putting the shoes of peace on with feet made of clay. We're mixing ourselves with the world. Why do you think they said that? He said, be holy for as I am holy. He said, without holiness, no one shall see God. You cannot allow yourself to experience a hostile takeover from the enemy. He will exploit your vulnerabilities, and you will be destroyed. Even if somehow you make it through this life limping, we will all stand before the Lord in a great white lobby. We back on now. We're live again. I believe that's the first time that's ever happened. Amen? Game on. I won't tell y'all who called me. I'll just call him back later. Amen? I'll tell him what he did. The merging with the world will lead to a hostile takeover. And I believe that we as Christians have to be careful what we compromise with in this world that is so fast-paced. Amen? You ever merge onto an interstate? You merge on an interstate at a fast pace on a highway. When you merge onto an interstate, you've got to get in there just right. And if you don't, it'll get you. I believe the enemy wants to keep us from yielding to the Spirit and constantly get us chasing, merging at all times and all places in ways that we were not meant to merge. Why? Because he wants a hostile takeover. He either wants you wrecking off the side of the road or not being able to fit into the mold that God has created for you and not being able to go with the flow of the Spirit so that you can't get in there and go under the anointing to do what God has called you to do. And I want to parallel this tonight with Matthew chapter 12, where it says, a house divided cannot stand. A house divided cannot stand. Jesus, I'm just going to skip to the meat of the part here, but it's Matthew 12, 22 through 28. It says in verse 25, "But Jesus knew their thoughts and said to them, every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation, and every city or house divided against itself will not stand." I know that there's an old song I used to listen to, not a gospel song, but a DC Talk song. No, it was a Supertones. Not that that matters. But it says, it's not Hollywood that's the problem. It's not Washington that's the problem. They're problems. But ultimately, they're not the problem. The problem is a weak, divided church of schismed Christians. Amen? And that can speak to two things. That can speak, one, to this interdenominational squabbling over things that don't matter, majoring on minors. I know we've got to preserve the truth in the Word of God, and we can't give way on that, give ground on that. But I also know that it also can refer to Christians, the word says, have a form of godliness but deny the power therein. A form of godliness, the iron, but deny the power therein, the clay. By merging and mixing yourself with the world, setting yourself up for hostile takeover, you have a form of godliness. You have potential, God-given potential, God-created potential. You have potential that God has locked into you because He made you in His image. But because of the world, it gets corrupted. The mind, in fact, if you read Romans 1, it tells you that because you exchange the truth of God for a lie that's emerging with the world, I know what's true, but it don't appeal to me nearly as much as this lie I want. And the merging with the world causes your mind to become reprobate. You tell yourself the lie so much that you believe it. The iron becomes the clay. It didn't say iron sharpens clay. It didn't say that clay sharpens iron. It says that iron sharpens iron. Christians, not that we forsake the world, but they need to surround themselves with like-minded people that believe the Word of God, that hold the Word of God to be true. You should never let somebody get too closely into your inner circle that has too much clay in their lives. Iron sharpens iron. And you should never, I've heard a wise piece of advice, you should never be the smartest person in your circle either. Always find somebody in your circle that is wiser than you. If you don't have anybody, go find somebody. You influence others and let others influence you, but iron sharpens iron. We make ourselves vulnerable to hostile takeovers, mergers with the spirit of the enemy when we constantly compromise and we add clay where there should be iron. In John 3 and 6, it says, when he's talking to Nicodemus, he said, "That which is born of the flesh is flesh. But that which is born of the Spirit is spirit." Talking about the secret, hidden things of God. We know no eye has seen, no ear has heard, neither has it entered into the heart of man what God hath prepared for those who love Him, but the Spirit. For witnessing that we are the children of God, it says the Spirit Himself witnesses with our spirit. And the one I've been quoting from John 4 and 24, it says, God is Spirit, and those who worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. In 1 Corinthians 6 and 17 it says, but he who is joined in the Lord is one spirit. We know we serve one Lord, one faith, one baptism. There's one God in three persons. A divine union. I want to end with this, and I've shared this before, but this came to my mind just before I came to preach the sermon tonight. And this is by a Scottish theologian, James Stewart. Heard Ravi Zacharias quote this on more than one occasion, and it's kind of become something noteworthy to me that I cling closely to. I want you to see what a godly union looks like. We talk about a man and a woman being made one flesh. You know, and what God hath joined together, let no man put asunder. We talk about how two become one. There's a merging. Amen? A merger between two separate souls, two separate individuals until God makes them one. But we then also know the analogy that we are the bride of Christ. And there is a merging between the church and the Spirit of God. Amen? Jesus emptied himself. He thinking itself, though he was worthy to be considered the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, he emptied himself and humbled himself even to the point of obedience of dying on the cross in the form of a lowly servant, even as he had come in a lowly manger and dying upon the cross so that we could be given access to this merger. A holy merger between your spirit and God's. God emptied himself so that he could be poured out into you. Ooh, somebody needs that tonight. And when you invite Jesus into your heart, when you accept his free gift of eternal salvation, and you welcome his divine grace and mercy, and you welcome those into your life, there is a merger that takes place. Just as a man and woman unite in marriage in a holy ceremony where man becomes united with woman and man and woman only, become united in a holy matrimony, the two being two flesh become one, so there is a holy matrimony between your spirit and God's spirit. And the whole point is so there can be an indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Just as God asked the people of God to build a temple, a tabernacle for his Holy Spirit to come and dwell and live in, so Jesus has prepared you to be the receptor of the Holy Spirit. He says, listen, I've gone to the right hand of the Father. That's where he ascended to be, at the right hand of the Father, to ever live, to make intercession for you. I'm there now pleading my blood over you, preparing a place for you. And in my Father's house there are many rooms. If there were not, I would have told you. But in the meantime, I'm sending my Spirit as earnest as a down payment for what you shall receive in glory. And that was what which was poured out on the day of Pentecost. Why? Because Jesus did not want his church operating in anything but his spirit. He needed a merger between his Holy Spirit, a holy union between his spirit and the spirit of man, so that they could be quickened and brought alive, and they would have a direct communication with God through which they could be anointed to preach the gospel. Not just with words, but with the very way that they live. An indwelling, a constant feeling. Not F-E-E-L-I-N-G, but F-I-L-L-I-N-G, a constant feeling. We focus too much on the feeling and not enough on the filling. We do. Feeling's good, but feeling can be empty. We need the filling.
There's no emptiness in filling. How do you know? By their works you shall know them. Filling is connected with work. The filling bone is connected to the work bone, the good work bone. So these men are not drunk as ye suppose, but they are filled with the Spirit as prophesied by Joel, that in the last days I would pour out my Spirit on all flesh. Now here's a point where we could squabble and disagree. Some say just then, just right then, that's all. They're missing out. I'm missing out. But you know what? If you serve God long enough, true enough, and you seek God's face, He'll bring revelation. It ain't my job to create hierarchy within the kingdom of God and saying we're more holier than y'all because we're Pentecostal and you ain't. It ain't our job to play God with unbelievers. It ain't our job to play God with believers. Love them as you love God. Serve them as you serve God. Don't talk down on them because they haven't yet received the feeling of the Holy Spirit. Because most of the time when y'all are saying that, you're saying feeling anyway, not feeling. Those who hunger and thirst for righteousness shall be filled. The greatest moments in my life that I have ever felt the indwelling and the filling, F-I-L-L-I-N-G, of the Holy Spirit is in ministering and serving others. And I may experience something sometime at an altar somewhere that I cannot explain. But God does my splaining for me. He does. I might want to give them the F-E-E-L-I-N-G, F-E-E-L-I-N-G of what I felt here at the altar. But what God is interested in them getting the F-I-L-L-I-N-G, the feeling that you got at the altar. And how shall they know that? By the way that you go out and live and serve. The Holy Spirit has already endued you, has already clothed you, has already empowered you, has already emboldened you, and you become a cup that overflows, and they begin to get hungry and thirsty for righteousness. And if they do, they shall be filled. Lord, we get it backwards and wrong, Lord. They got to get hungry and thirsty before they can get filled. Just like I can't grab a brother or sister out of there and try to force them to be saved, I can't get a brother or sister who's denying and force them to get filled. They get hungry enough. They get thirsty enough. God will let them feast and dine at the master's table and they'll get filled. Lead them to Jesus and He will do the rest. So there's a divine merger. Iron sharpening iron. You see where I'm connecting all of this now? My job is not to bring clay into the mix by creating that hierarchy. My job is to be iron and to sharpen their iron. If you think their iron's a little dull, don't call it clay. Get your iron out and sharpen their iron out. And you might be surprised at how much your iron gets sharpened and realize how dull you really were through the work you do under the anointing of the Holy Spirit as you minister in love. I believe we live too secularly. That we live a life compromised. Let me end with this. If y'all talk, flip a coin, we didn't talk about it. Somebody come play for a minute. Let me end with this tonight. Wherever you're at, whenever you listen to this, I want you to take these next few moments a little serious. There's two types of mergers that can take place on this earth. You can allow for a holy merger between your nature and God's nature. Not that you become God, but it is our goal to become Christ-like through a filling of the Holy Spirit.
And what you do away with the vulnerabilities, that's what it means to be sanctified through and through. It's a never-ending work of the Holy Spirit in your life. God desires for all of His believers to be merged with Him. Because a house divided cannot stand. And even if you manage to stand on feet of clay, you won't remain standing. And if you ever find yourself in that situation where you're broken because of the sandy or the clay foundation that you managed to lay has given way when the hard times of life has come. You know, I believe that in the hard times and in the hard places, that's where the hand of God begins to work and to make you realize your vulnerabilities, your limitations. That rock is not meant to crush those that believe and trust in God. It's meant to be the rock that you stand on, that you live on. It's meant to be the mountain that you ascend to. That's why it says that the righteous fall down, but they get up again. Because they know it don't depend on them, but it depends on the rock they're standing on. But the sinner will just lay in self-pity and whine and cry about that sandy clay foundation that he had built his life upon has now been destroyed. Don't recognize the futility in the life that they were building, how it was always pointless all along. And the truth just caught up with them. If you're living a lie right now, you've been given a hostile takeover. If you're living a lie in your life right now and you're duplicitous in your thinking, you're double-minded. You're serving two masters. A house divided cannot stand. And God in His mercy and grace is begging you and pleading with you. Even in the midst of this crisis, He's looking to you with eyes of mercy and with eyes of grace. And He's saying, son, thy sins are forgiven. Iron was not meant to mix with clay. I feel the Holy Spirit in this tonight. Somebody under the sound of my voice. It may be in some far distant place. It may be right here in this room. But I feel the Spirit and the power of God in this place. And I know that His presence is here. And I know His presence is with you. Let me tell you something. You can make an altar right where you're at. You can begin to pray to God in response to the word that you have received. And as you pray, that iron will begin to sharpen iron. And any sandy foundations in your life, any clay that you've managed to mix in with the elements, God is saying, I want to wash those away. My blood was shed to get rid of those. Those don't belong in the life of a believer. They can't remain. It's my job to replace those with iron. Because there's coming a day. Amen. There's coming a day. There's coming a day. One day. When every knee shall bow and every tongue confess, the rock is coming. I want to be standing on the rock. Don't you? I want blessed assurance. I want to know that I know that I know. I want no doubt in my mind. I'm praying wherever you're at right now that you feel that assurance in your life. And if you don't have it, you're asking God for it. Right now, take this time as she sings this, you and God. You don't need me. One mediator.
In the
it's Christ Jesus.
Presence of Jehovah,
Father, we just thank you for this time that we've had in your presence tonight, as that song was saying, Lord, in the presence of Jehovah. God, we thank you so much for this time that we've had tonight. I know this word has went out, Lord, and it's not going to return void. That right now, Lord, that word is settling in. And I pray that everywhere it goes, Lord, that it wouldn't fall on the shallow ground or among the weeds and the thorns. God, that it wouldn't be done away with, Lord, but that it would be planted on good soil. I hope that those that prayed, and I pray that those that pray right now, Lord, are letting it fall into good soil and let it begin to produce good works in their life, God. God, that's your desire, to make us better. God, to take us from glory to glory. God, that if we've already grown some, God, to grow us more. If we've already grown a lot, to stretch us even further, Lord. But God, some of us are just beginning. And I pray, God, that your Spirit would visit them right now and confirm the word that was preached tonight. God, I pray for all of those, God, that were under the sound of this voice and this ministry, Lord. And I pray that you would be right in the midst of it. Be with each and every family that's watching. Watch over them as we plead the blood of Jesus over them and over this sickness that is in our land. I plead the blood of Jesus over every household and over every family, and mine included. And we pray in agreement together as brothers and sisters in Christ. It's in Christ's holy name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Be blessed and have a wonderful week. Join us again on Sunday morning at 11 a.m. Enjoy the devotions.